Grace upon grace. He says in his word, he resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Then I started to discover, even after receiving the grace of salvation, which I did not work for. By the way, he did not start to work with me when I came to know him. No, he started to work with you when you were still in the beer hall, when you were still a murderer, when you were still worshiping the dead, when you were still very sinful. Because of what he put in your life, he preserved you by grace. Many of you, you don't know, you can actually recall how you escaped accidents. Some of you actually, you were shocked how you survived in an accident when you are that sinful. How you made it after robbing a family and the police were after you. They got you, there was a shooting there, but you never died. Yes, you went to prison, you came out, you are still there. Why are you being preserved? I started to ask, apart from the salvation story, where you get the grace of God in abundance, I'm seeing grace upon grace. Now in your life, as you go from one place to the other, as you go from one level to the other, the grace of God is now upon your life, and it started way back when you were still in the world. God was preserving. And I asked myself one question, but why? Why? Because I was sinful. And the Lord said to me, because of the purposes of God in your life, the purposes of God that were put in your life before the foundations of the world, that's why you are still alive today. That's why you are still walking when you were that sinful. God said, I will preserve him. One day he will come back to me. And I want you to tell everybody here, even the politicians who are here, I want you to know this. You are not alive today because of wisdom. Yes. God sees something that he puts in you and he says, I'll preserve this. No matter what happens, I'll preserve this. This one will not die in him. So it's not so much about yourself, but it's about the purposes of God in your life. And when you find the purpose of God in your life, you start to flow. You start to please God. You start to, heaven stands up and claps hands for you. And grace upon grace starts to come into your life. Now, the Bible has said, Ephesians 2:8, not by works, lest any man should boast. I want you in this meeting today to come out of this place knowing how you can maintain 24/7 grace coming into your life, in ministry, at your workplace, education, wherever. How can you maintain grace even in ministry? We've heard you can't work for it. But how can you maintain the grace of God upon your life? Now, I've told you, the Bible is very, very clear in the book of James chapter 4. It says that he resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Right there, mama, right there, my dear young man, there is a position in the life of a child of God which guarantees a flow of grace into your life. You can't work for it. You cannot work for it. It has to be a position that you maintain in your life, and then grace continues to pour in your life. Actually, the Bible also says that if it is by grace, then if it is by works, then it's no longer grace. If it is by works, then is no longer grace. And if it is by grace, then works are not involved. Don't we work? Don't we do things? We should. Brethren, we have seen, I gave my life to Jesus Christ in 1972. And I'll tell you my story just in few minutes, 2 minutes or so. Right from the beginning, I knew there's something upon my life. I was seeing in AFM, in a very big conference in Urube there, many people in a mountain. I was seeing, and the people would be saying, who is seeing? That small boy. I used to have dreams, visions that are very big. I shan't go into that, but my point is, during those years, there were great, great people, great servants of the Lord that rose up in those years. And some with, born in the same area, born at the same time, with eloquence of speech, dexterity of speech when they stand in front of people, but could not lead many people. It was always a few people until they gave up. In the 70s, there's many great saints of the Lord that rose up, and there are many that gave up. Say to somebody, how is it that somebody who is laboring so much as a founder of a church for years and nothing has happened? Yet somebody just comes up and all of a sudden there's a big following. I want to qualify this and say it has something to do with grace. The grace of God upon somebody's life for a specific function. Where God says, without it, you cannot accomplish anything that you were born for. You were born for something, and I want to say to somebody today, you were born for something great in your life. You were born for great things, but you need the grace of God upon your life. Now, I want to illustrate this with the story of Gideon. And then I'm done. The story of Gideon is amazing. Now you listen to it. It's the book of Judges chapter 6. The Midianites are wreaking havoc to the children of Israel. Every year, they would wait for the Israelites to reap. Reaping time, that's when they would come and swoop over the fields and take everything. And this happened year in, year out. And so on this very day, Gideon, a young man, is taken, he's actually in a wine press, and the wine press is doing something that you should never do in a wine press. Arukupura jingabeshiyo wine press. And the voice comes, the angel of the Lord says, men of Allah. He looks up and he says, how do you say that? How do you say that? Where are the miracles that our forefathers told us that we crossed the Red Sea? There were miracles. We had all those things come our way. How is it that we are in this predicament where everything that we work hard for is taken away so quickly? And then the Lord continued. You see, God doesn't wait for your rambling. When you are in trouble, he goes to the point. And he says, go in this your might. I want you to deliver the children of Israel from the Midianites. And he says something. He says, how can it be? Our clan is the last clan. I'm the last born in my family. The clan is the last clan in Manasseh. If he was to expand, he would say, Manasseh himself was supposed to be the firstborn. But when Jacob prayed for the two children, he switched hands. And so we are coming from a family that has no blessing. I'm the least. I'm nothing. I'm not educated. I don't have any degree in a country way. At least you must have a degree or a PhD. A PhD to lecture at the university or something like that. I don't have that. And I'm the last born in my family. I'm looked down upon by every member of the family. How can you say that I can deliver the children of Israel from the Midianites? How can that be? Because we are the least in the whole chain. And God says, go ahead. You are going to deliver the children of Israel in this your might. What can that be if it's not grace? What can that be if it's not grace? Now, listen to the detail. He then says, how many soldiers do you have? And Gideon says, I have 32,000 men. And I think he was feeling very, very strong. He was saying, I've got 32,000 men, so I can wipe out the Midianites. And God said, no, there are too many. There are too many. I want you to know from this meeting how you can position yourself, the grace of God to flow in your life all the way through. There are too many. Now, what you only do here is go back to the army and ask them a question. How many are afraid? And all those other afraid must go back home. How many are afraid? Go back home. He eliminated the afraid and then said, how many do you have now? He said, 10,000. Actually, 22,000, it remained. 10,000 there. They said, no, there are too many now. In chapter 7, God now clarifies why he wants him to reduce his soldiers. And he says, reduce your soldiers. These are too many, lest Israel gets the glory. Lest Israel gets the glory. Son, I want to give you this with all my heart. The key to the flow of grace in your life, the key is in everything, God must receive the glory. In your life, in everything that you do, God must receive the glory. In everything, even when you go to work, when you get a job, right at that moment, receive the glory. When everyone else has been turned away in an interview and you finally get that job, please, it's not about your intelligence, it's not about your wisdom. You must stand up right outside the interview room and say, Father, in it all, I know I went to school, I know I've got education, but in it all, Father, I give you the glory. If it had not been of you, then I would not be what I am today. This is the key for the flow of grace in your life. The Bible says, had it not been of the Lord who was on our side. Now let Israel say, had it not been of the Lord who was on our side, oh, our enemies would have swallowed us and eaten us alive. Had it not been of the Lord. When you struggle like this, I want to say to you, you cannot wait for grace, but you can position yourself for grace. And today there are some people in this meeting who have been thrown away from family to family, changed from family to family. Actually, when you were still very young, grade one, you did it with another family. You were kicked away to stay with an uncle. You were kicked away to stay with an aunt. And you got your education in bits and pieces. And you right now you're looking down upon yourself. You say, what can come out of Israel? What can come out of Nazareth? Nothing can come out of Nazareth. When it's like that, my daughter, you are really positioned for grace. Why? Because God always wants to receive all the glory. He has to receive all the glory. When he receives glory, Then he says, give him whatever he wants. Grace will come upon your life. And today the Lord told me, just stretch out your hands as you preach, because I'm showering my grace upon some people who were looked down upon, even in this nation. They've told you, you are nothing, you will amount to nothing, you are rising to nothing. But I'm here as a servant of the Lord to tell you, God ordained you in that position, in whatever you have been called to do, whatever it is, the Lord has chosen you, and no one can fight you and win, because it's by grace. Oh, the grace of God is in the meeting today. Position yourself, mama. Position yourself, because God is about to pour out his grace. The grace of God comes because of brokenness. Brokenness. It comes because of brokenness. I don't deserve it. Even when you have a little favor, my sister, my brother, just a little thing, praise God the whole night like you are mad. You've just received a small thing. I want you to learn to give glory to God. We give you glory, Father. We give you glory, Jesus. We thank you even for our nation, Zimbabwe. We give you glory for our nation. Because in this broken state, we are about to receive the grace of God. The grace of God. The grace of God. And brethren, it's not about people. It's not about abilities. It's not about our strength. When God comes on the scene, he changes everything totally. Everything is turned around. God has come in the scene finally. I want to say to my ministers, fellow ministers, it doesn't matter you've got 10 people before you today. You've got 20 people before you today. You've been traveling for many years with few people. I want you to know it's only one day, my young man. It's only one day. Only one day. Only one day. God does not need months, does not need years to turn around a situation. Our God is powerful. Our God is well able to do exceedingly abundantly above that which we can ask or think, according to the power that works within. The power is already within you. Your word says we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may not be of us, but of God. You see, it's all about him. The excellence of the power may not be of us, but of God. We are hard pressed on all sides, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Seen. Because the things that are seen are temporal, but things that are not seen are eternal. So we are saying, can you see grace? You can't, but you can see its force. Once grace comes upon your life, young man, you cannot die easily. What I put in here before the foundations of the world cannot just go just like that. Because you see, you were born for a purpose. You were born for a purpose by God. And that purpose has nothing to do with you. It has something to do with the giver, the one who gave the purpose. So when the purpose is upon your life, you shall live, you shall not die. You need the grace of God just to flow in your life. So I say to this meeting today, I say to every pastor who is here, reduce your soldiers. Reduce your soldiers, mama. I see you. You can actually bring down your husband from head to toe. You can just denigrate him every day. You're trying to change him by your power. You actually can speak the whole night. He says, tomorrow I'm going to work. Please, let's be quiet. You say, no, this thing, man, we must finish it tonight. And you go on speaking. You want to try and change him in your own power. When you do that, Loving was created by you. That's the day when God starts to work in your life. What is it? What is it? Is it ministry, son? The day you hand it over to God. One day, one son just phoned me and said, "Baba, come." I think it was in Mutoko. He says, "Baba, please come very quickly. If you don't come quickly, the church will just disintegrate." I said, "I don't have a church. I am a steward. This church belongs to Jesus Christ. And if he leaves crumble, it's him." When you do this, that's when God steps in. And when God steps in, what the devil does is picnic. What the enemy tries to do is just picnic, because God is well able to do exceedingly in everything that he does. And I want to say to you today, the grace of God is in the meeting. You have heard the word of God. You have understood the word of God. The grace of God is hanging in this place. There are some people walking out with the grace to prosper in whatever they are doing in their life. There is a grace that's coming upon your life now. And by the way, I say that day, grace cannot be copied. You can't just say somebody has got this grace in this area, I'll just copy and start a church and I'll do the same. No. When the grace comes upon your life, it's specifically for the purpose that you were created for. Listen, you were born to answer questions all over the world. You were born to answer questions in Zimbabwe. You were born to answer questions in Africa. You were born to answer. There are people walking with a question mark. And you were born. Who knows? There's somebody waiting for you in Afghanistan. Somebody waiting for you in Australia. Who knows? Because of what God has put in your life. But for you to flow well, reduce soldiers. Listen, if you can figure it out, there's no grace. If you still can figure it out. I want to say to somebody, the Spirit of the Lord is saying to me, when you kneel down in the middle of the night and you say, "I don't know what to do." If you don't intervene here, I'm done. Watanga manoma. You've just started. But if you can figure it out quickly and put 1 plus 1 is equal to 2 quickly,